So,
Komal, shall we?
Yes, yes, doctor.
Again, you have gone to the flyer screen. You need to put the gallery view.
Yeah, yeah. Should I gallery view? Better.
So I have shared my screen.
Okay.
So you can change the view from your side.
Okay.
Yeah. So thank you and welcome everyone for this webinar. So my name is Komal Kanojia, working as a brand manager with IVY MCure. And MCure is pioneer in the field of gynecology and also in IVF. And we at IVA are on a mission of nurturing 28 days of ovarian cycle, and Materna being the epitome and the quality brand from IVA. So I would like to thank Dr. Muttaja and Dr. Rishikesh Pai, Dr. Anjali Kanhare for giving us this opportunity of hosting this webinar of POGS today. Thank you so much, doctor. So just before going ahead, I would like to hand over the mic to Dr. Mudita Jain and would give a short introduction of her. So she is working as a professor of obstetrics and gynecology and present secretary of Bhopal Obstetrics and Gynecology Society. So Dr. Mudita Jain, over to you.
Thank you so much. Thank you all on behalf of Bhopal Obstetrics and Gynecology Society for joining us today for this webinar. Thank you, Paisa. Thank you, Bapat ma'am. And thank you, Anjali ma'am, for giving us opportunity to perform this webinar today. So I would like to start with Paisa introduction. Thank you so much. Sir is MD, FRCOG, UK, FCPS, FICOG, MSc, USC. Sir is at present Medical Director, Bloom IVF Group. Sir is President-elect, FOCSI 2022-2023. Sir's area of interest is Administrator, FOCSI, Manyata Initiative, Director, Corporate Affairs, IFFS, International Federation of Fertility Society. Adjunct Assistant Professor at Eastern Virginia Medical School, USA. Sir is, first I would like to invite our chairpersons for today's session. I'm so sorry.
Okay, Mudita, you can continue.
It's okay.
Actually, it is always very nice to read Dr. Pai's CV, so I can understand that. Please go ahead. that is always a pleasure to read his CV. So please go ahead.
I'm so sorry.
No, that's okay. Ma'am, first
I would like to invite our chairpersons, Dr. Anjali Kanhare, Madam, President, Bhopal Obstetrics and Gynecology Society. Madam is Professor and Head of Department, Chirayu Medical College. Sir is Madam is Femur Fellow and from GSMC Mumbai 2011 and SCME 2018. Welcome, Madam. I would like to invite Dr. Meeta Agrawal, Madam, as second chairperson for today's session. Madam is a very senior consultant from Bhopal. Madam has done MBBS, MD-OG from LLRM Medical College, Madam, with gold medal. Madam is senior private practitioner in Bhopal and practicing since 30 years. Madam is past president Bhopal FOCSI 2015 to 2016. Madam is past secretary IMS Bhopal chapter 2014, awarded FICOG in 2014. Madam has done CIMP 2014, presented paper in FIGO 2018 at Rio, Brazil. Madam has presented poster in FIGO at Rio, Brazil. Madam is member of State Supervisory Board, PCPNDT. Welcome, Madam. Madam, now
thank you.
Anjali, Madam, for taking the whole session.
So, Dr. Rishikesh, you can share your
screen. Yeah. So, yeah. Thank you.
I think before sir starts his presentation, thank you so much, sir, for giving us this opportunity. And Kavita madam, because we are looking forward to working with both of you. And it is going to be Bhopal's proud moment because we are going to share our website today in front of dynamic members of FOCSI. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Anjali. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, we can.
Yeah, Dr. Anjali, President, Dr. Meeta Agarwal, leading gynecologist from Bhopal, and all my friends are there. Dr. Kavita Bapad will now become the Vice President, Dynamic, Shashi Srivastava, Mangala Kavde, my friend, and Varuna Patak, and many of you who are there in the audience. I would like to thank you all for inviting me for today's talk. So, recurrent miscarriage is defined as the loss of three or more consecutive pregnancies. This includes biochemical pregnancy, biochemical till 24 weeks. So RCOG is three consecutive, while ASRM is loss of two or more clinical pregnancies. In this case, the pregnancy is considered as requiring ultrasound or histological confirmation, thereby excluding biochemical. And then what is primary, secondary, tertiary? Primary RPL refers to multiple losses in a woman with no previous viable infant. Secondary RPL refers to multiple losses in a woman who has already had a pregnancy beyond 20 gestational weeks. And tertiary RPL refers to multiple pregnancy losses between normal pregnancies. What is the etiology? So the etiology, I normally use the ASRM 2012 definition, practice committee report. So they have divided it into two parts, explained and unexplained. So in unexplained, which is about 50%, you have parental chromosomal abnormality. One of the parent may be having a Robertsonian or a balanced translocation. You may have autoimmune Aplas syndrome, uterine structural defects, endocrine problems. And there are others which are not defined as such. You know, you may, they are still in research, infections, male factor, psychological, alloimmune, environmental, occupational, and personal habits. All of these are not defined definitive. This is the first one, two, three, and four are pakka defined. The remaining are not. Then you have the unexplained, 50%. In this, actually, you know, there is no etiology. So it is by exclusion, but in unexplained, actually the genetic etiology is 25%, because what we were doing was when we were doing the testing of the products of conceptors for genetic abnormality, we were using karyotyping, which was a very, you know, backward kind of technique. Karyotyping of the product of conceptors, you need to have the cells alive. They need to be proper. You have to avoid maternal contamination. So all this was very difficult, but now with the CGH microarray technology and with NGS technology, you can, when you do the same products of conceptors, you same do repeat analysis. Many of them are actually trisomy 16, 21, 7, 15, monosomies are there, triploidies are there. So with the CGH microarray and NGS technology, suddenly 45% of these unexplained now can be explained based on the genetic etiology. And this is a beautiful paper by Popescu in 2018 in Human Reproduction, which has analyzed 100 recurrent abortion POCs and then has come to this conclusion. And very few, 5 to 10% may be actually true unexplained, and they may be of immunological origin. So the main, if there's an older woman, they have shown that there's 100 times more chance of a miscarriage, and you can't do anything for this unless you do egg donation. So this is one thing which you have to understand. If you look at the parental chromosomal abnormality, incidence is 4 to 5%. It can be balanced or reciprocal or Robertsonian translocation. And maybe you do it in these following things: family history of genetic disease, elderly patient, couple has different difficulty in conceiving, aneuploid abortuses, especially products of conception are tested by microarray and NGS. But in our country, because karyotyping is so cheap, that you can do it as a routine also. In USA, it becomes very costly. So they have to justify doing it. In our country, in the workup, we do karyotyping, husband, wife, it costs 3,500, 2,000 rupees. So it doesn't matter. But abroad, they have to justify why they are doing karyotyping. So in our country, when we are doing workup, you may do it routinely. But there, in their country, they will do it only if one of these criteria is satisfied. So when should we do it? Should be done in all cases. So I feel that second abortion, first is okay, a sporadic one. You can't wait for three abortions, practically speaking. So second abortion onwards, you must start doing testing of the aborted fetus, preferably using a microarray or NGS. The new technology that has come is NGS technology. Not karyotyping should not be done. Maternal contamination should be ruled out. So there are now new techniques which you can rule out whether these cells that you are actually analyzing are not maternal, no, by mistake. It helps us to classify unexplained RPL. So if suppose the product of conceptors is having genetic abnormality, you know it's a genetic cause. But if it is not having genetic abnormality, you know that it is a mother maternal cause. So it helps you to classify the etiology of unexplained. Helps us to confirm the genetic etiology and helps us in focusing on parental causes. So if there is a normal karyotype on POC, you know, there may be a parental reason, and parental causes can be focused on. So if there is a genetic cause like a Robertsonian or reciprocal translocation causing abortions, then there's a lot of papers that have shown that if you don't do anything, they will have multiple conceptions and ultimately have a normal child. However, if you do, you offer them pre-implantation genetic testing, they may get pregnant a bit earlier. The at a faster, you can't tell a patient, "Acha, 5-6 abortion hone to ultimately you will have a normal child." But so you have to offer something, then you can offer them a PGTA. So, what is the role of pre-implantation genetic testing in couples with a chromosomal defect? So, genetic counsel is essential. Embryos with unbalanced chromosomal arrangements can be screened by PGTA or PGTA-SR. SR means the new terminology now. Pre-implantation genetic testing for aneuploidy. Older terminology was PGS. Now it is PGTA. And for translocation, it is called SR. That is called structural rearrangement, PGT for structural rearrangement of the chromosome. The overall birth rate have not been shown to be higher with PGTA compared with natural conception, according to Murugappan in Human Reproduction in 2016. However, it remains possible that PGT in couples with structural chromosomal defect might reduce the number of miscarriages experienced prior to a successful live birth, decrease the time taken to pregnancy, and decrease the emotional stress and uncertainty for a patient till a positive pregnancy. You can't tell them, "Acha, keep on having miscarriage." So many couples who are more aggressive, you know, they'll say, no, sir, doctor, 2 abortions are there. You please do something. So then we offer them pre-implantation genetic testing and testing the normal embryo and putting it back. So a modified IVF cycle. What about immunological causes? So there is Rh isomerization, autoimmune disorders, like can be APLA, anti-lupus, anti-nuclear antibodies, and anti-thyroid bodies are normally done to look for autoimmune. And there can be, if everything else is not there, then there will be alloimmune. So as far as the autoimmune disorders are concerned, the acquired autoimmune disorders are called, there are thrombophilia. So there are 2 types, acquired and inherited. Acquired thrombophilia is called antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, APLA, which acts by inhibition of tropoplastic function, thrombosis of uteroplacental vasculature and initiation of a local inflammatory response at the maternal fetal interface. While inherited thrombophilias include hereditary conditions like factor V Leydig mutation, prothrombin gene mutation, protein C deficiency, protein S deficiency, antithrombin deficiency, their relationship is with early fetal loss is very less clear. This is the inherited thrombophilias don't really contribute to recurrent pregnancy loss. Very rarely it may, but APLA, yes, it contributes. So APLA is defined as 1 clinical and 1 lab. You all know that, so I'll not go it. So 1 clinical can be vascular thrombosis or 3 or more consecutive pregnancy losses, fetal deaths, and a lab criteria also has to be there. So repeated at least 2 times, more than 12 weeks apart. So anti-cardiolipin antibody, anti-beta 2 glycoprotein 1 antibody and lupus anticoagulant. So one of these should be positive and 1 clinical should be positive to have APLA. What is the treatment? You can give them unfractionated heparin with aspirin, or you can give them also low molecular weight with aspirin, which has shown to have equally good result, because unfractionated heparin, of course, is the best, but very scary. You may have bleeds and all that. So better to go for a more safer treatment. What about congenital thrombophilia? I told you that it doesn't really have a connection. For the present, it is not recommended that recurrent miscarriage patients should be routinely screened from thrombophilia unless otherwise indicated due to prior deep venous thrombosis, VT embolism, or be given antithrombotic prophylaxis even if a thrombophilic defect is found. What about Müllerian defect? That's the next. So anatomical is also definitely accepted. So overall incidence is 5% in women, infertile women 3%, recurrent spontaneous abortion women 5 to 10%. And if they have a second, third trimester preterm, more than 25%. So if you look at the uterus, acquired or congenital anomalies can be there, which will normally manifest as decreased vascularity in case of a septum, increased inflammation in case of a fibroid or adenomyosis, and decreased sensitivity to steroid hormones. Congenital anomalies are there, and you have the consensus group where you, by doing a 3D, you can easily now make out whether there is a congenital abnormality. And with the 3D, you can also make out acquired abnormalities like polyps, fibroids, or adenomyosis. And you can diagnose them with a 3D. So 3D ultrasound with a sonohistogram is enough. MRIs and all you don't really need. And if there is any abnormality, you treat the abnormality with laparoscopy, hysteroscopy. We all know that, you know, hysteroscopy, laparoscopy will give very good outcomes. And ACRMS, that's why I said in 2017 that until better quality evidence emerges, the ASRM proposes that it is reasonable to undertake surgical correction in cases of uterine cavity defects associated with fibroids, polyps, and adhesions. So then comes the endocrinological problem, the fourth accepted problem, thyroid, pituitary, or pancreas, so hypothyroidism, especially if the TSH is more than 4. If it is more than 2, you need to have antithyroid antibodies positive. But, you know, in actual practicality, anything more than 2, 2.5, you can put them on thyroxine supplementation. And so the American Thyroid Association has given strong recommendation for thyroxine use with combined autoimmunity and TSH more than 4, and a weak recommendation to consider thyroxine with autoimmunity and TSH more than 2.5. Pituitary hyperprolactinemia, if the level is more than 23.3, you can start her on bromargocriptine or cabergoline. And in diabetes, if the FGP1C is more than 6.4, you do a GTT. And if there is a diabetes, you treat the diabetes. What about the contributing factors? So these are the one that I told you are the definitive factors. Now let us come to the gray zone factors. I'll just tell you these factors, but they are not definitely proven. Like you have the PCOD, no. She may have insulin resistance, and there is definite increase in the miscarriage rate in patients with PCOD. You may have luteal phase defect, you know, day 21 progesterone less than 10 nanogram per ml, shortened menstrual cycles clinically, premenstrual spotting. So these may be treated by progesterone treatment, and the PCOD may be treated by metformin. You may have a poor ovarian reserve, which will decrease the quality of oocytes, quantity of oocytes. And you can give them supplements, et cetera, and try to improve the performance. You may have infection. So this has become a big thing now, chronic endometritis. So you have to, if you want to diagnose chronic endometritis, you have to do a hysteroscopy and you'll see focal or diffuse hyperemia in the endometrium. And there may be polypoidal endometrium and micropolyps. And the histopathology, this is very important. You need to do an immunohistochemistry and you will need to look at a CD138 plasma cell. And if there are more than 5 plasma cells per 20 to 30 high power fields, you can tag it as a chronic endometritis. Give them doxycycline or ciprofloxacin metronidazole combination. And after that, you give them lactobacillus to repopulate the endometrium. And this has shown to improve in some patients of recurrent abortion. You can empirically give it. In our country, you don't need to do all this. You can do a DNC. If there's endometritis, great. If not, you give a doxycos, but nowadays with mucormycosis, we better not give it for too much. So 5-7 days, initially I used to give 21 days doxy, but I'm getting scared. So nowadays I've reduced it to 11 days. I said, let's not push our luck too much. If you give it for a long time and they have diabetes or something, mucormycosis should not hit them if they get COVID also. What about endometriosis and adenomyosis? It can cause RPL and this is due to inflammation. So in endometriosis, there is alteration of oocytes and embryo because of toxicity. Inflammation-mediated histological changes in the endometrium. Adenomyosis, inflammation in the endometrium, uterine contractility, abnormal implantation. These are the causes in adenomyosis. There is no one single therapeutic approach which has emerged. Basically, euploid embryo transfer in frozen transfer after giving 2-3 shots of GnRH agonist to suppress the endometriosis or the adenomyosis gives very good outcome. Vitamin D deficiency can be there level less than 30, or you may have a selenium deficiency. There are, you know, these are all like, you know, not definitely proven. So I'm just rattling the male factor. There is a trend towards repeated miscarriages with abnormal sperm. So you can do a sperm fish. If the sperm fish is highly abnormal, your sperm chromosome aneuploidy testing is abnormal. You may think in terms of a male factor and offer them IVF. And offer them sperm selection techniques to do the IVF and create better quality embryos. Sperm DNA fragmentation, if it is more than 30, it can be, you know, we can say, okay, there may be a possible male factor contribution. So we normally give them antioxidants to reduce the, do a repeat sperm DNA fragmentation, see whether it is less than 30, and then try for a pregnancy. Miscellaneous things like environmental and chemical stress, anesthetic gases like nitrous oxide, formaldehyde, pesticide, lead, mercury may cause sporadic spontaneous losses. There's no evidence of association with RPL. Personal habits like obesity, smoking, alcohol, caffeine intake is the essence change is not clear. Exercise, hyperhomocysteinemia can cause, but these are all sporadic. I told you the four important ones are the hormone, endocrinological factors, the anatomical factors, the APLA syndrome, and the fourth is the karyotyping, abnormal karyotyping in one of the parents, balance or Robert. Baki ka, everything is query. Unexplained, after ruling on this, unexplained is 45 to 50. But as I told you, Popescu's paper has shown that out of this 50%, 45% are due to genetic reason. Abnormal embryos causing abortion. So if you do a NGS, next-gen sequencing analysis, nowadays in our lab, we have got a genetic lab called Bofiki lab, where we do NGS of the on the POCs. So you can send it about 12,000, 14,000, we can do that. But that will give exact accuracy, because if NGS is showing normal or abnormal, you know whether there's a parental etiology or there is a genetic etiology. Alloimmune causes. So now coming to the alloimmune, 5 to 10% may be alloimmune. So these are all variegated etiologies. I mean, there is a lot of mixture of different etiologies. So there are close histocompatibility between partners causing impune response, lack of antipaternal HLA lymphocytotoxic antibody, absence of circulating blocking factor, which results in maternal lymphocytes attacking the conceptor, increase in natural killer cell activity of more than 80%, increase in T1 lymphocytes as compared to T2 lymphocytes. So there are various etiologies. This is a different etiologies, we have all clubbed them together. And that's why when we do any analysis of the meta-analysis of the alloimmune treatments, they don't have a statistically significant outcome because we have not yet understood, we have to sub-classify them. So how do you diagnose alloimmune etiology? There are many tests that are available now. These are anti-nuclear antibody, which is available in India. Lymphocyte cross-match for husband and wife is available in India. Serum TN-alpha for wife. And testing NK cell, the blood by cell sorter CD56 for wife. These are available in India. The other ones are anti-paternal lymphocytotoxic antibody, mixed lymphocyte culture, paternal human leukocyte antigen testing, natural killer cell cytotoxic assay, testing NK population in the decidua by immunohistochemistry. This is also available. But most of the time, we do the diagnosis by exclusion. So what is the diagnosis by exclusion? If there's a normal parental karyotype, normal HbA1c, normal 3D ultrasound cavity, no abnormality on hysteroscopy, normal thyroid function, normal prolactin, no APLA, and additional tests, maybe normal antithyroid, normal anti-nuclear, no aneuploidy in POC, killer immunoglobulin. This is a new test that has come in ASRM. Just I was reading it. I have not yet gone to the actual performance of the test. They have given a link. So killer immunoglobulin like KIR receptor expression on uterine natural killer cell 1 and fetal human leukocyte antigen HLA-C expression by extravillous troposcopy EBT. So this is a new test that has come which can prove that is an alloimmune cause. So, but most of the time by excluding these, by everything having normal, that is why there is a chance that it may be an alloimmune disorder. So if you have got, if you say, okay, I found that nothing is abnormal and now I have come to the alloimmune treatment. So what would be the treatment in that case? You may do immunopotentiation and modulation treatments, which will be progesterone or IVIG, intralipids, steroids, paternal leukocyte immunization, G-CSF, hydroxychloroquine, and you may do anti-inflammatory treatment like aspirin, heparin, steroids. So these are two different. And you can give GnRH agonist also, which is an anti-inflammatory because we are giving GnRH agonist also. So in recurrent abortions or recurrent implantation failure, if you are doing IVF, then we will give two shots of GnRH agonist, knock out all the inflammation, and then create the lining and do the transfer, preferably of a genetically tested euploid blastocyst and get a very high chance of outcome. So what is the role of progesterone in RPL? So it is, you know that if there's a abnormal fetus, there is a progesterone induces what is known as PIBF. And if there is a higher PIBF, it will cause asymmetric antibodies, TH2 lymphocyte, NK cell bias, and fetal will be protected. On the other hand, if there's a low progesterone, you will have asymmetric antibodies, TH1 bias, killer cells, and it will cause cytotoxic inflammatory reaction and cause abortion. So the interact. So you give progesterone therapy. Progesterone can increase PIBF, improve outcome. You can give oral dihydrogesterone, other micronized progesterones, as well as injectable HCG, which has all shown to decrease the miscarriage rate. There is no demonstrable increased risk of birth defects or teratogenicity in this patient. So there are various studies of progesterone supplementation. The one of them was the PROMISE study, which involved 836 women with idiopathic recurrent miscarriage, randomized to receive either 400 milligrams of vaginal micronized progesterone twice daily or placebo from the time of positive pregnancy test to 12 weeks. There was no difference between the two groups in miscarriage or live birth rate. This was Kumar Swamy. And Kumar Swamy is a very intelligent man. He's a fantastic PhD in UK, very, very, very respected in the international community. And he published a study in New England Journal of Medicine 2015. And then came Saccon study, infertility study in 2017. That was a meta-analysis of 10 RCTs, which included the PROMISE study as well, involving 1,586 women. PROMISE was a study which was 36 women. This was 1,586 women with idiopathic recurrent miscarriage. And he evaluated the effects of natural and synthetic progesterone administered during the first trimester and commenced after pregnancy confirmation. There was lower miscarriage and higher live birth rates, which were found in the 8 studies that used the synthetic dihydrogestrone. So PROMISE study was not showing any outcome, but the meta-analysis of the advanced study, which included the PROMISE study, showed better outcome, especially in those which were using dihydrogestrone. Synthetic progesterone may be superior to natural progesterone, at least when progesterone is commenced after the positive pregnancy test. However, formulation, dose, and route need to be defined. Natural progesterone may be beneficial, but should be started in the luteal phase with consideration given to continuing beyond the first trimester. You can also give HCG besides triggering ovulation, downregulates maternal cellular immunity to promote implantation, promotes angiogenic activity in the endometrium. Rarely, there's a rare cases of reported autoantibodies against HCG, but normally 5,000 twice a week, but I don't give it so much in my practice, but many people give it and they have good outcomes with it. What about ANA? So does the presence of a positive anti-nuclear antibody in a woman with otherwise unexplained RPL constitute autoimmunity? So if the prevalence of positive ANA in the general population is significant, 20%. If you do a subgroup analysis, they demonstrated that low titers of ANA, that is 1 in 80, are not associated with RPL. However, higher titers, that is 1 in 160, showed a significant association between ANA and RPL. So you can give empirical, if there's an ANA positive, especially 1 in 160, you can give empirical low-risk therapy with low-dose aspirin, 100 milligram daily, or low-dose glucocorticoid you can give, 10 milligram. But now with COVID and all, we avoid that. Or you can give hydroxychloroquine, which may be reasonable for presumed autoimmune mechanism. So you can give any of these three, if especially ANA is positive, more than 1 in 160 dilution titer. Methylprednisolone, which I use a lot, used to use, but now again, I am not using it at present because of the COVID, can be used. And there is a study which has shown better outcome, TANG study. But there are problems with it. You have to counsel the patient for prematurity, orofacial, cleft lip can be there, gestational diabetes can occur, hypertension can be unmasked, avascular necrosis of femur head can occur as well. One of my patients had an avascular necrosis of femur head, mainly used in ANA positive patients of autoimmune disorder, and you need to exclude antiphospholipid syndrome. In APLA, you would use heparin plus aspirin. In all other ANA positive patients, you can use prednisolone, but nowadays with the COVID and mucormycosis, it is avoidable. IVIG can also be given, and the mechanism of action is, you know, you do give IVIG, and a lot of doctors have been giving IVIG, especially with very good outcome. You give them 0.5 gram per kilogram body weight for 5 days, repeat every 3 weeks, 0.3 gram per kilogram till 24 weeks. The side effects are hypertension, nausea, headache, anaphylaxis, and it decreases killer activity of NK cells, increases activity of suppressor T cells, suppresses B cell production of autoantibodies, contains antibodies to antibodies or anti-idiotypic antibody. And it also has Fc receptors, which include binding of complement by the Fc component of IgG. So a lot of people, not many, because we are scared, because complication can cause death also. There are two meta-analyses recently on IVIG used in recurrent miscarriage. They found no evidence of improved live birth rates. But there are 10 randomized trials in women with recurrent pregnancy loss. In meta-analysis of all trials, no significant impact on live birth rate has been reported. In contrast, in sensitivity analysis, IVIG significantly increased live birth rates when initiated prior to conception, and it had a borderline significant therapeutic effect in women with secondary RPL. So that when you classify primary, secondary, tertiary, this is where the secondary RPL classification will come in. Instead of IVIG, you can also give intralipid. So it's called poor man's IVIG. What is intralipid? That is a 20% fat emulsion of soya bean oil, egg yolk, phospholipid, and glycerin. And this may reduce the peripheral blood natural killer cell activity and suppress pro-inflammatory cytokines. You take 2 to 4 ml, it is very thick. It is used in hyperalimentation in chronically morbid patients. So you take 2 to 4 ml, you can't give it directly IV, it will cause thrombophlebitis. So you dilute it in 250 ml of saline and give it over 1 to 2 hours. That's how we do it in our unit, every 3 to 4 weeks till 24th week of pregnancy. But nowadays, I've been a little, you know, with the COVID and all, I have not been so aggressive, because I give it in my recurrent pregnancy loss patients also. We have been a bit tentative. We don't know whether to use these immunomodulators with COVID going around. You know, if the patient develops COVID, then what will happen? So we are a bit tentative about aggressively using them, except, you know, heparin, low molecular weight heparin. I am cool with it because it's a treatment for COVID anyway. 42% pregnancy rate in 64 women with previous IVF failures and 90% pregnancy rate in 11 patients with recurrent pregnancy loss. This was Akashio in Fertility Sterility 2008. So this is about intralipid. And then we can, this is Dr. Mohan Raut, my friend's favorite baby, paternal leukocyte immunotherapy. So LIT is offered to overcome immunodeficiency. Paternal leukocytes can be used, donor leukocytes, sensitio trophoblast membrane, leukocyte rich in erythrocytes. It is controversial. Very few people will use it. Even abroad, hardly anyone does it, because we are all scared. May have some benefit in poor prognosis patients. So you collect four, this is the standard, I don't know what Mohan Rao does it, but normally they collect 400 ml of blood. Leukocytes are separated with density gradient method, washed twice with autologous plasma. Lymphocytes suspended in maternal plasma. 3 ml are given IV, 0.5 ml are given in 2 subcutaneous doses, 0.25 ml in 4 intradermal doses. If there is an NTD, you give it, single or multiple dose given. Nowadays, I think Dr. Rao is only giving the intradermal part, so it is more safer. And transfusion reactions are there, autoimmunity, difficult to obtain a suitable donor cross-match if organ transplant is needed in the future. There's a recent meta-analysis of allogenic lymphocyte, which reported improved live birth rate in treatment arm, Cavalcante in 2017. However, these studies have been criticized for their low quality, low number of patients, and lack of consistency in the patients that are recruited. Normally, some of them, I send to Mohan, Dr. Mohan Rao, and he gives the therapy and they have a good outcome, but I'm still confused about it in my mind, you know, what exactly. But when there is a patient with a lot of abortions, I say, okay, go and do the therapy, and after that, we'll do our IVF treatment. You can also give anti-tumor necrosis factor, TNF-alpha adalimumab, but you have to be careful that there is no tuberculosis, because if you give it, it can flare the tuberculosis. So I don't think we should use that. You can give GCSF, you can give it daily subcutaneously. And there's a study by Scarpellini in 2009, one small RCT of 68 women with unexplained recurrent miscarriage, found that the GCSF treatment administered daily subcutaneously from the 6th day after ovulation to the 9th week of gestation, 1 microgram per kilogram daily, increased live birth rates from 48% in the placebo arm to 83% in the treatment group. More recently, a pilot RCT found no benefit following intrauterine GCSF administered in an unexplained recurrent pregnancy loss. So subcutaneous GCSF, there is a study which has shown, and you can try it out. What about giving empirical heparin and aspirin, or heparin and or aspirin to people, and this is the SPINS trial, Scottish Pregnancy Intervention Study, which showed no difference in outcome in patients with unexplained RPL taking heparin plus aspirin. So other thing which you also need to do is lifestyle modification. So you can do, patient be advised that modifiable factors such as obesity, coffee not to have more than 3 cups a day, alcohol not to have 3 to 5 drinks a week, smoking not to smoke, and cocaine use should be can be linked. So you should try to improve your lifestyle. You can have good diet, exercise, stress-free life, mindfulness, and yoga. Good nutritional status, you know, correct the anemia, vitamin B12, vitamin D, adequate supplements, antioxidants, micronutrients, psychological support. This is a very well-known study by Stray Pedersen, and he had a cohort of 158 couples with 3 consecutive pregnancy losses and no otherwise identifiable etiology, and divided them into 2 groups, one receiving routine obstetric care during the next pregnancy, and the other additionally receiving tender loving care, TLC. TLC was defined as psychological support with weekly medical and ultrasonographic examination and instructions to the patient how to avoid heavy work, travel, sexual activity. The difference in live birth was significant, 36% in the control group and 85% in the TLC group. So psychology, so there are a lot of recurrent pregnancy loss clinics in the UK who are specialized. So they have fancy clinics where people go, they're counseled well, their lifestyle is changed, their dietary habits are changed. They all the time are interacting with the doctors. And with this, apparently there's a huge change and outcome in the live birth rate. Recurrent pregnancy loss patients are prone to heightened anger, depression, anxiety, and feeling of grief and guilt. 2 non-randomized studies have shown significant improvement of subsequent pregnancy outcome with close monitoring and support at a dedicated recurrent pregnancy loss clinic. So what is the role of PGT? So everything is normal. Maybe Dr. Pai has got a PGT. So can you do PGT instead? Just do IVF, get the embryos, test them, do a blastocyst testing, do genetic testing, get the right euploid embryo and put it in. Indeed, no RCT has looked at the beneficial impact of PGTA in couples with RPL who are normal karyotype. There are 2 types. Couple has got an abnormal Robertson or balanced translocation and you do PGTA, it is justified. But in a couple who has got nothing now, 7 miscarriages, I've recently done a patient with 9 miscarriages, PGTA I have done. And I put the embryo, became pregnant, but again miscarried. So now we have got still 5 normal embryos. So we have suggested surrogacy for that couple. So it's not that a PGTA will definitely respond in a normal. It will not cause a miscarriage because you never know. It may still have a maternal factor or there's an interactive factor. An abnormal embryo causing an abnormal maternal response, which can also cause miscarriage. However, despite a lack of conclusive evidence, a recent survey comprising of PGS experts from Europe and United States showed that repeated miscarriages were, with repeated implantation failure, the most frequent indication for PGS in their respective center. This was a 2016 report. So PGTA can also be combined with sperm selection. I was just now reading a new article in Fertility Sterility. They said that a male factor, a bad sperm may contribute. So by improving the sperm selection and then creating embryos so that you increase the number of euploid embryos, test them and then select the best embryo and put it in. Newer technologies such as non-invasive PGTA, time-lapse technology, IDS core, ERICA will help us to select euploid embryos with minimum invasiveness. So of course, another very good treatment is surrogacy. I found that surrogacy, you take the embryo and put. So there is definitely, though ideally the uterine factor is very low, most of the studies are showing that the contribution by the embryo is more than the uterine factor. Where the uterus is normal, there is no adenomyosis, no fibroid, hysteroscopy is normal, there's no endometriosis, so there's no normal uterine factor, abnormal uterus. In that also, surrogacy with self or donor egg will, in difficult cases, will give good results. So what are the conclusions? RPL is defined by 2 or more failed clinical pregnancies. But in my case, you can't keep on waiting for the second also. First abortion, okay? Second, you should not wait for. At least I feel in first abortion, because in India, the treatments are very cheap. You can do a blood sugar, thyroid, prolactin, do a 3D ultrasound to rule out anatomical. You can do ENS. You can do all these things, very karyotype of husband and wife. Everything can be done very quickly. So you should not wait for the second abortion. My thought is that we should go first abortion. Okay, at least general test, you should do and rule out anything. Up to 50% of cases of RPL will not have a clearly defined etiology. The majority of miscarriages are sporadic and are thought to result from genetic causes of influence by maternal age. Peripheral karyotyping analysis of the parents. If positive, genetic counseling should be done with the advice that 40 to 60% will take a baby home by 5 years without doing anything. However, PGTA may be offered with caution and with informed consent. APLA screening should be done for lupus anticoagulant, anticardiolipin antibodies, and anti-beta 2 glycoprotein protein. And if positive, unfractionated heparin with low molecular weight heparin or low dose aspirin may be. So you can use heparin or low molecular weight heparin. Further investigation and treatment with no molecular weight heparin for non-criteria APS. So clinically positive, but ACL lupus anticoagulant levels are in high normal. This is called non-criteria antiphospholipid syndrome, should be looked at. Anatomic screening with 3D ultrasound, sonohistogram, histosalpingogram, and or hystroscopy is important. But now with the 3D UIG, so I always, when they come to me first, I don't have my 3D ultrasound. I should be investing in technology which is all over the country. I always believe in investing in technology which no one else has got. So if there is a patient first, I'll send them, refer them to a radiologist will do it better. So refer them to they have got 5-10 machines, one better than the other. So you send them to them, let them do their 3D ultrasound. And if there is abnormality, they will pick it up. So if it is positive, you correct it with the laparoscope, hysteroscope. Endocrine screening for thyroid, prolactin, diabetes to be done. Thyroxine treatment for TSH more than 4 MIU plus or minus with or without antithyroid. And if it TSH is 2.5, antithyroid antibody should be there before you start thyroxine. Cabergoline for hypoprolactinemia, metformin for frank diabetes, PCOD with insulin tolerance, and progesterone for LPD. Thrombophilia screening not indicated unless history of venous thromboembolism. If it is diagnosed, treat thrombophilia with low molecular weight heparin, not low molecular weight heparin with aspirin. That is a combination you use for APLA syndrome. For congenital thrombophilias, you use only low molecular weight heparin. Unexplained RPL may be due to embryonic chromosomal abnormalities or immunological problems. So it can be an embryo or immunology. Array CGH or NGS analysis of products of conception may be useful in setting of ongoing therapy for RPL. If this is positive, patient can be offered genetic counseling or IVF PGTA with proper explanation stating that there is a lack of evidence that PGTA may increase chances of live birth. If negative, one can look for parental contribution. If parental contribution is, you know, uterine factor or this factor or that factor, if parental contribution is not found, immunological causes may be present. So you derive immunological causes etiology by excluding genetic and parental etiology. There are numerous tests for immunological causes, but there is no gold standard. Tests like ENA, antithyroid antibody, TNF, alpha, and NK cell in peripheral blood and endometrium are available, but inaccurate. They are not definitive. At present, all the immunotherapies except oral progesterone, that is dihydrogestone, or micronized progesterone are not recommended. Progesterone should be started as soon as pregnancy test is positive and continued beyond the first trimester. One can give steroids, aspirin, or hydroxychloroquine in ANA positive patients. Psychological counseling and support should be offered to couples with recurrent pregnancy loss. Tender loving care, TLC, in the form of dedicated ultrasound clinic with regular follow-up, lifestyle modification, stress busting, decreased intake of alcohol, caffeine, tobacco, as well as reduction in BMI is helpful. Personally, for patients with high order RPL, we can offer IVF with embryo selection using PGTA. There are other techniques also available, and we can combine them with progesterone, aspirin, low molecular weight heparin, intralipids, steroids, and we can throw in more, doctor, you know, the immunotherapy. You can try. We do not use IVIG in our unit. We can also offer them surrogacy. So thank you for a very patient hearing. Thank you.
Nice.
Thank you, Pai sir. It was wonderful. Just there is one question, and I think the answer they wanted from you. The question is, in EPLA with RPL, dose of aspirin is 70 or 150, and when started and stopped?
Yeah, 150 is a better dose. Nowadays, a lot of studies have shown 150 you can give also. But I would prefer 70. I'm always worried about complications. You know? So, you know, I feel, and you know, if there's a bleed somewhere and this and that. So, I'm more worried about the mother than the baby. But yes, 150 would be better. What was the other part of the question?
When to start and when to stop it?
That some many people, I still started after the pregnancy is positive. It doesn't really matter. But many people started before also. I skipped that slide when to exactly start it. Because I was just telling the general, basically, the policy, what you should use.
And when to stop it?
Stopping again is a issue 24 weeks. Some people, like sometimes, you know, you take it till even 34 weeks. There's no definitive ground as to when to stop it, because you're always worried that she may abort, you know, once you stop it. But 20, you know, at least 20, 24 weeks, you should continue. Many people continue till term also.
Yes, thank you, sir. Even I wanted to ask, nowadays we are getting many obese patients.
Probably mentioned it through the review.
So is there any difference in doses of aspirin or LMWH?
Yeah, I think I normally would refer them to the specialist, but obviously if there's an obese patient, then maybe we'll have to modify the dose, you know. But I think one of the treatments for EPLA would be to bring their weight down anyway before. So nowadays, now even for my IVA patients, when my residents are telling me, I said, please, now when you talk BMI, I should know. So if the BMI is more than 27, I have a tie-up with 2-3 weight loss specialists, I automatically send them to them. So I said, you please go there and get your weight loss done and then come to me. So many of them become pregnant also with the weight loss. They don't have to come to me. So weight is a very big, I think weight loss, lifestyle modification, mindfulness, yoga, all these things are very important. And if you see in the COVID time, a lot of people have become pregnant naturally also, because they couldn't go to the doctor, so they became pregnant. So yeah, I think it's just a matter of time and patience that is there, which is probably in our hectic day-to-day life, we don't have that in routine. Now we are in the COVID time, we are forced to have it.
Yes, right.
So a lot of our IVF patients also were waiting, became pregnant on their own because I think BMI is a very operational, you know, BMI is our biggest enemy. So one of the things we have to keep on doing is how to improve the BMI. You know, I always believe that Kavita, who is our cyclist from Pune? I forget the name. The president of Pune Society.
Let me allow to smooth this piece. Pundarikli. Sir, got me. The abdomen therapy. Unmute. Hello?
Dr. Patwardhan.
Patwardhan. Yes. Peace hai bola na maine. Sir, you are muted.
Dr. Pai, you are muted.
Patwardhan always says abdominal girth, you should reduce.
Girth.
You know, so the everything is boils down to the girth.
Very true.
And actually, what he says is very true. But, you know, everyone, whenever he says it, everyone tries to avoid him because, you know, that it's very difficult to get the girth down.
Right. So, passport photo theek hona chahiye. Pura kya karna
hai? Madam, that is okay if you have Zoom meetings. Offline meeting, then you will have to be active, and I know Dr. Kavita is one of the active person anyway. I have seen her like this for years and ages together.
Yes.
I think that.
Thank you, Pai sir. It was a wonderful.
Thank you.
Sir, please spare a few more minutes for our website launch.
Yeah, of course.
I would, ma'am, should I continue?
Yes, please go ahead.
Now I would like to invite Dr. Varuna for she is our website committee in charge of Bhopal, and now I am handing over mic to her for our website launch.
Javita madam, will just take 5 to 7 minutes, not more than that.
Then don't worry about me. Just don't worry.
Thank you so much, Mudita. A very good evening to everybody present online. And may I request respected Pai sir and Kavita ma'am to just stay back for some more time. Kavita ma'am is with us any which ways. And all the respected chairpersons who are with us, the presidents and secretaries of the other society who have joined us today for this event. And of course, our body, that is our spirit and soul, the precious members of our own very society who are with us. I request all of you to stay back for a little more time as we announce, which means that finally that moment and that day has come when we finally announce the launch of our website. Before I take the final plunge and call it on, I would want to use this opportunity to share a little thought with you that this website, which is going to be a reality now in just a few moments, has been the vision of nobody else but then our own much lovable and much respected Dr. Anjali Kanhari, the president of our society. I remember one that fine evening when she was about to be sworn in as the president, and I had called her up just to share that, Didi, how about having our own newsletter? Least was I aware of the fact that there were bigger dreams she was harboring inside. Sweetly, she said, yes, of course, why not, kind of a response I got. But only to realize that when she was sworn in, she chose me and she endowed me with this responsibility. I feel blessed for this. And that her vision, her thought, her dream is today evening blooming into a reality in the form of the first website of the OBGY Society of Madhya Pradesh. We are very proud of it. To have this turn into reality was with us all the time, our very enthusiastic, energyful, cooperative Dr. Mudita Jain, our secretary. Then my committee members, I'm thankful to them. Dr. Neetu Mishra is always there with me. Dr. Hemlata Parashar. My vote of thanks would not be over if I do not thank Dr. Shweta, who was cardinal during the inception phase of the society. Unfortunately, she's not been able to join us today for health reasons. Then, of course, the Insignia people, Akshita, the girl who's actually the IT girl who has taken up this responsibility and transformed this into what it's going to be. And of course, everybody's blessings, but then blessings are never complete without the blessings of Saraswati, whose Vandana is going to be, she's going to have her blessings with us. May I request Dr. Amit to please play the virtual Saraswati Vandana and the lamp lighting. शारदा Kamal, thank you so much. So with the blessings of Ma Saraswati, may I now take the honor to call our own website live. We'll have the homepage being shown to us live. Our website is accessible at our link. We can have the link shown.
Kamal, sir.
Kamal can, yeah.
This is the link from where it can be accessed.
So I'll just...
Kamal, please click the link.
It is there on Facebook. You can access it for to have a glimpse of the Bhopal Obstetrics and Gynec Society. That's the home page, which has its navigation bars. There is a section on About Us, the gallery, which has all our photographs, our videos of the memory lanes, an announcement of the conferences, this photo gallery thing. This is all live. You can go through it. The conferences, the achievements and booklets, as in we have now a lot of enthusiastic members in our society who are constantly achieving things, national platforms, international platforms. Why should we keep it all that to ourselves? Let the world know what we are and what we are doing. So this section is going to do that. Whatever all the trainings that we conduct, that we plan to conduct, because with the Dr. Anjali Kanare as the president, there's so much of emphasis on PG training programs which are taking place. So we have a calendar of all the training programs that are going to be taking place all the while, even in future. And then there are the contact us details to the extreme right. Now this, members, is our page. This is our niche. We have to keep this alive. Whatever we do, whatever we intend to do, because I remember when I was collecting all this information from the seniors like Dr. Madhuri Chandra, Gore Madam, Dr. Kanhare Madam, I admired the way they had kept all the souvenirs and their memories intact, compiled together. But it must have taken some effort for them to keep all those things organized so well. Now we have a common platform. We're all going to keep everything about us on this page for each one of us to see, for so many more to see. So ours is a society with a very glorious past and an equally more promising future. So here we announce, here we show what we are all about. I want words from my president. Didi, your dream finally comes true.
Yes, Dr. Varuna, it was a dream coming true today. But I think we should give this opportunity and probably get blessings from Bhai sir and Kavita madam so that we know how.
Definitely,
we are
achieving. Ma'am.
So please, I think we'll go ahead and ask them.
Ma'am, just one last word I missed upon. There is a review section to this site. So people are also requested to please put their reviews about the site.
Yes, so that if we can have anything more into the site, we can incorporate it right now. And if there are any more suggestions,
yes,
we'll be more than happy to take care of those suggestions, because we want all the society members to contribute in this big event which we are doing today. We have so many people
doing social surveys,
doing cycling. They have cycling class.
Yes, ma'am.
And this is my dream, that we want to put everything on this website so that we know what others are also doing. Rather than, as you have rightly said, keeping it to ourselves, I want it to be an open page, at least for all our members, so that we know each other more, in a more friendly manner. Thank you so much for...
Ma'am, today it is a newborn baby today. It's just a newborn baby today. All
yes.
of us will nurture it and develop it the way we want to.
Yes, yes, definitely.
Sure, ma'am.
I think congratulations.
Hi,
it's a lovely site, a lovely, beautiful site you have made. Congrats, Varuna and Dr. Anjali. Great, great work with and
sir.
All the team. And I'm sure that it will, you know, flourish, you know. So this small baby will become an adult in no time. And it
yes,
will
sir,
flourish and become,
forward,
and right? As madam said, that you have to do all that. And maybe also connect it to your, you know, like Facebook and, you know, You should yeah, have your WhatsApp group and all that. You connect the site. So it will be good and, you know, interactive as well. Right. And remember, you know, one of the important things you need to keep doing is stay together, you know, when there's any True. Medico-legal problem. So these are various ways of platforms to connect each to each other.
Yes, sir. Definitely.
So there is a surprise element to this site, which I have not announced because there is a surprise. It will be a surprise for our members.
Congrats.
Still do wait. I can see that smile on Anjali Didi's face.
Congratulations.
Yes, yeah. Kavita ma'am, please come.
Congratulations, Varuna and Anjali and Mudita. Really creditable. और इसको सबको फेसबुक लाइव पे इंस्टाग्राम पे और मेरा और ऋषिकेश पाई का फोटो लगा के जरा दिखा देना प्राउड टू बी अ सोसाइटी ऑफ मध्य प्रदेश थैंक यू सो मच मैम
मैम आई वुड नाउ लाइक टू इनवाइट अंजलि मैडम फॉर अनाउंसिंग फ्यू प्राइजेस ऑफ अवर सोसाइटीज व्हिच वी हैड डन इन पास्ट फ्यू मंथ्स on the Mother's Day. Hand over mic to Anjali madam.
I think Madhita, the best part of being on webinar is you can mute or unmute your mic as and when you require.
Yes.
So the prizes of essay and poetry, since we didn't get too many, all our members were busy with the COVID pandemic, we got a couple of entries and I would like to say that those were beautiful aspects which I came to know about my members. The prize, today I'm going to announce just first prize because I have another responsibility which has been given by Kavita Madam to have a Bhopal Connect page. And the rest of the prizes and the rest of the write-ups will go on that page. We will be launching soon. So the first prize today, I'm so proud to announce, it goes to Dr. Vandana Kundargi and to Dr. Anita Srivastav. It is a joint prize. Both of them are for poetry, and the third and fourth prize will, second and third prize will announce soon. And I take this opportunity to thank all my team members, the executive body, because they were there always with me, and all my senior members told me that just go ahead and just do it. And I'm so thankful to all my senior members and all my team members for making this dream of having the Bhopal website come true. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much, Anjali ma'am. Thank you, dear Pai sir and Kavita ma'am, for spending few minutes with us. Now,
Thank you so much.
Now, I would like to invite our second session chairpersons, Dr. Sashi Srivastav ma'am and Dr. Mangala Kavde ma'am. Komal, can you show me the slides of Mangala ma'am and Sashi ma'am? Dr. Shashi Srivastav ma'am is very senior consultant from Bhopal. Ma'am is running Saurabh Nursing Home from last 35 years. And I came to know ma'am is a very good friend of Kavita ma'am also.
My dear batchmate, we started our careers together.
That is why I pulled Shashi ma'am. She's so sweet and so humble that if she is very happy to be in her own cocoon. So I thought, no, on this platform today, I would love to have Shashi madam today with us.
Our admission day is same, our medical checkup being done at the same day when we got our entry into the college and everything together. Hostel mein bhi room pass mein tha.
Yes, I know that.
I'd like Thank to you. Call now Mangala ma'am CV, please. Come on. Dr. Mangala Kavde ma'am is also very senior consultant. Ma'am is fertility specialist and minimal invasive surgeon. Madam is Director, Nest IVF Center, Bhopal, pioneering starting the first test tube baby center of Bhopal in 2001 to 2013. Welcome, Madam, to the sessions today.
Thank you so much. Good evening, everyone. Mudita, it's fine because the CV which I had sent, probably that is not being displayed. It's okay. And thank you very much for uploading this one because I had given a very short CV. So without wasting much of time, I welcome Dr. Kavita Bapat for her today's talk and excellent talk, sir, Rishikesh Pai sir. And he has always been our mentor and you know, we have been learning so much from you, sir. And thank you so much. It was a real, real good talk and many things were there which to be discussed, but we can have it in another session. And I request Dr. Shashi Srivastava to introduce Dr. Kavita Bapat. Thank you so much.
Do Bhopal Society require my introduction? I'm really feeling odd. And after yes, the
let us have this privilege. Let us have this privilege.
It is a warm welcome in this rainy monsoon season. We have shower academic feast. We have Dr. Kavita Bapat, a great academician and great surgeon. She is the queen of one-day hysterectomy. She is the one and only one, the director of the one center of the gynecological excellence, Bapat Hospital at Bapat Square, Indore. She has many awards, an award winning of NICA of Indore, captain of industries. She is vice president of FOXI 2021, president of Indian Menopause Society, vice president of MPARC, secretary of MPIH, executive member of ISAR, and many more feather in her cap. And she is the one of the organizing secretary of long awaiting ICOG Indore. Well, welcome, Kavita.
Love you, Shashi. Love you always. Such a long awaiting. You are so right, so much right. Hogi ki nahi hogi, iska bhi a question. So love you, Shashi. And I'm sure after Rishikesh Pai's lecture, I'm sure kisi ko interest hai ki nahi endometriosis sunne mein. I'm not sure of it. But still, I share my screen and I'll let you know. The topic is really close to my heart, the future of endometriosis. Really, I'm extremely sorry for this. Just stop sharing, just wait. So the topic being given to me today, my God, ye to ulta pilta ho gaya. Bas slide pehle khulte hain aur peeche jaate. Endometriosis is a very enigmatic disease and it's really troublesome. We all know, we all are troubled by it. And the Baba to Baba, Pathy to Pathy, we'll go and do it like this. My screen is visible?
No.
Okay. I'm sharing my screen and I'm let you know. Sorry. I'm extremely sorry for my this behavior. So the future management of endometriosis. Today you are going to listen the future. Characterized by the growth of ectopic endometrium outside the uterus. We all know everything about endometriosis, and especially in the month of March, we talk so much about endometriosis. And with this year, with all the webinar, I'm sure everybody is with all the topics flooding on them, and everybody is too much knowledgeable this year because of the webinar. But still, you have given me the chance, and thanks MQR also and Bhopal Society for giving me the chance to speak on the subject, which is very close to my heart. But it is still unknown etiology. Treatments usually aim diminishing pain and achieving pregnancy. The problem is so much with this. Now, again, despite some progress in defining mode of action of the drug development and lack of reliable animal models indicate that novel approaches are required. This is the only system in only thing endometriosis. If we'll get the best biomarkers, that will be the best thing will happen in the advances or the future of endometriosis, I always feel about, because it needs simple biomarkers are needed to diagnose, because although the ultrasonography is the best thing, still we say the biomarkers are needed. And difficulties to inherent to modeling of the endometriosis are related to its multifactorial nature. It's not able to make a good model over it. And condition that hinders the recreation of its pathology and identification of clinically relevant matrices to assess the drug efficacy. So these are the problems. Now I'm not going into the detail. These are the sites for the endometriosis and the ovary, cul-de-sac, uterocycles. We all know extrapelvic, intestinal, cecum, lung, thorax. And for my surprise also, the day before last month, we did a before COVID of the 1 month back, that there was a mass into the breast and it came out to be the endometrioma. So it was surprising. I am going to present it soon. So these are the site and these are the rarest, the extremities are also there. Now what we cope up with the endometriosis is an epigenetic disease. It's a disease of coping, basically disease of theories, frustrating patients and challenging items. I'm sure a patient of endometriosis from one gynecologist to another gynecologist, another gynecologist to another gynecologist. She just goes from one doctor to another And because the drug is costly sometimes they are not able to make her happy because it's a really, really a frustrating disease. Though there are improved diagnostic tools and they have a multimodal approach, but the model, the approach is just right from the radical to conservative and from reserves to practice pitfalls. We all see the endometriosis patient once it started, and even 30 years back when we started our medical school and everything, at that time the adolescent endometriosis was not there. So in a future perspective, adolescent endometriosis is also now this is. Now why newer concepts are required? It's described by the Daniel Shoren in 1690. It was not its definitive cause. I'm just putting a few points of history. And it's an enigmatic disease owing to lack of specific symptoms and poorly understood pathogenesis and limited effective therapeutic options. In last three decades, have witnessed a significant volume of research related to endometriosis. Endometriosis is a disease jiske liye bahut sare drugs hain, bahut sari pharma companies are working on it. And this is a very favorite disease for the pharma company as well as the gynecologist. So many volume of research related to it and increasing incidence. We have finding there is a definitely increase in incidence of endometriosis, and it is because of changing lifestyle, increased awareness. Awareness has gone beyond and better diagnostic modalities. So these are the newer concepts are required. And the first point is it inherited? There is a no Mendelian pattern of inheritance and a multifactorial inheritance is suggested. Number two is the risk of endometriosis is 7 times more in a first degree relative if affected. 75% incidence in a monozygotic twins. No mutations have been identified so far. Then there is an ancient classification. This is a newer classification because I am talking about the future of the endometriosis. This is an ancient classification. Though it started early, it's a comprehensive classification basically. And it's a surgical score system classification proposed by Chapron, introduced in Austria in 2005. The ancient score is just like RSRM classification is determined by the extent of endometriosis during surgery. Then there are two revisions being done in ancient classification 2010 and 11 to correct the overlap between these two systems. And revised ancient classification was simplified by dividing retroperitoneal structures and three components. So it's my suggestion, whenever you find out, while do the sonography, just write the ancient classification as we write a palm coin classification into the cases of AUB. Similarly, we should write the ancient classification, and these are like that. If there is a peritoneum, P1, P2, P3, and if ovary, O1, left or right, you can say O1, O2, O3, depending upon, and how is the size, less than 3 centimeter, 3 to 7 centimeter, more than 7 centimeter, same with ovary. Then the tube is also very, very important, adhesions, mobility, patency test. If the pelvic side wall are involved, pelvic side wall of the uterus are not involved, pelvic side wall, uterus, bowel are there. So this is also important. Now the symptoms again, there may be dyspnea, dyspareunia, dyschichia, BD is very important, dysuria and backache, acute abdominal pain, premenstrual syndrome, menstrual bleeding with menorrhagia, cyclic hematuria with menstruation, and the most important again is a variable, need high index of suspicion, usually delay in many. Sometimes we don't see anything and we find it out so many things. So there is a delay in many years, symptoms and a definitive diagnosis. Now, the most important point, which is infertility and endometriosis. This troubles the most because patients come for two things, either the AUB with it or sometimes infertility and a deep pain. These are three things basically, but the AUB and infertility is there. And principles of laparoscopic surgery for infertility are similar to the surgical training and expertise for the best outcome. Ovarian reserve should be considered prior to surgery. And surgery and ART should be considered complementary strategies. So whenever there is endometriosis and infertility, this is very, very important points. Then the another infertility point, we should do the cystectomy for the endometriomas larger than 4 centimeter in diameter. And if possible, improves fertility more than a simple ablation, drainage and coagulation. Cystectomy should be performed with the expertise and a care, identifying tissue planes, carrying out a careful dissection, and avoiding the removal of surrounding ovarian tissue. So once the laparoscopic being done in those patients, so we should be worried about, and we should be, there should be right tissue plane, right dissection, and right removal of the ovarian tissue is very, very important. And suturing versus coagulation, hemostasis is better in order not to affect ovarian reserve. Young patients should be counseled about the oocyte cryopreservation prior to the ovarian surgery. Again, the surgery for a deep infiltrating endometriosis should be considered as a second-line treatment after the failed IVF. Pregnancy rates after repeat surgery are low. Two cycles of IVF might be more effective than second surgery. Post-operative medical management, post-operative medical hormonal therapies delayed do not enhance pregnancy. And this is except in the case of severe endometriosis before IVF. IUI combined with ovarian stimulation is effective option, provided that the tubes, these are the guidelines which I am talking about. The use of gonadotropins appears more effective than the Clomid. And IVF first line is a preference in more severe cases, advanced female age to reduce the sperm quality. So it's very, very important. Then again, the last one is of the infertility and endometriosis may have a negative impact on IVF success rate and mandatory if tubes are compromised and does not appear to increase the risk of recurrence of endometriosis. So if the IVF have been done, it's not, there are the chances of like that. And the recurrent endometriosis, spontaneous resolution occurs in 20%, and residual disease, persistence of symptoms or reappear of the symptoms within 3 months. Recurrence usually appears after the 3 months, and incidence 6 to 30% in various studies. It depends on the age, stage, prior treatment, surgery, and peritoneal disease. Now, we are worried about the recurrent endometriosis. This is a very, very important topic because patient is a really frustrated one because he, she, patient goes from one doctor to another and diagnosis rising 125 DBS, MRI, and laparoscopy. Though the 125, CA-125 doesn't have anything like that, but the strength still for the recurrent endometriosis patient needs painkillers, hormone, progesterone, OCPs, GnRH analogs, indicated if medical therapy fails and contraindicate for the intolerable side effect. This is a conservative surgery. Cystectomy, adhesionalysis is the option after IVF failure, and post-operative hormone therapy delays recurrence but does not reduce the recurrence. Now, LNG-IUCD, all of us know it's a taking a very much smart way, and it's a really the recent thing because we are talking about the future of endometriosis. So LNG-IUCD is also has got the role. And the hysterectomy and bilateral salpingogastrectomy, old time-tested disease thing treatment, but still to save the uterus is the another important thing. Then the role of surgery in pain in a future thing is ablation, then LUNA should be done, but there is currently no evidence is recommended to use the LUNA to treat endometriosis, and there is some evidence for the use of practical presacral urectomy. So the LUNA has gone. And why does happen? So there are so many theories. They are also the future one. This is the transplantation is the old one. But the cellular and a molecular etiology theories are for the endometriosis. Inflammatory and estrogen dependent disorder, it's a coming up. And induction theory of Merrill and genetic factors are also important. Endometriomas because of invagination, coelomic metaplasia and follicular. And we all see a lot of patients with the endometriomas. And these are because of these three things. These are also new things. Now, aromatase has got the role for the future endometriotic treatment also because it's a autologous this aromatase production at the site gave rise to full thickness infiltrating nodule and remnants of the metaplastic endometrial tissue. And this is a latest theory coming up, and considered this after checking that without any surgery at all, a nodule vanished after the prolonged anti-aromatase treatment. For DIE, there are two things, expression of matrix, metalloproteinase and activins, and different mechanism of neuroangiogenesis. Now, these are the epigenetic. These are two modulators which we talk about. This is the latest thing. Very, very latest in the future for the endometriosis. This is the one hypothesis because early and on onset of endometriosis by neonatal uterine bleeding. So whenever you see a patient with a vaginal bleeding at the earlier stage, we should be worried about that she may have endometriosis in the future. This is because of the cyclic menstruation. And another is a deep endometriosis, a specific type of abnormal endometrium like cell benign tumor. So the diagnosis is the same things. I'm not going into the detail, nothing new into it. Same with the medical history and same with the gynecological examination. But the fixation of index and uterus into the retroverted position, we should be considered about it, and it should be diagnosed as early as possible. Then these are the thing, what is the gold standard into the futuristic endometriosis is a transvaginal sonography. It will remain as a gold standard. It identifies the ovarian endometrioma. It identifies the adenomyosis, everything, and identify the cause of pelvic pain in endometriosis. And then the computed tomography is also there. Then MRI, it's a really best thing is happening if we will get the MRI done of the patient of endometriosis. It provides the added benefits. And endorectal sonography is another thing which is a future in this thing, and sigmoidoscopy. Role of Doppler, definitely there. There is a pericystic flow with RI more than 0.45, indicating low resistant waveform. Lab testing, there are several tests are coming up, but what is proper and what should be available, like RPL, Dr. Hrishikesh Pai has suggested so many new things, but what we do and what we can do is a big question. So C125, CA199, serum protein, PP14, this is the anti-modulatory antibodies, IL-6, IL-6 in a COVID time, we are really impressed by IL-6. So IL-6 is good for the endometriosis also. Peritoneal fluid, and then the macrophage migration inhibitory factor. There are nuclear factors, B-cell, B-cell lymphoma, anti-Mullerian hormone and tumor necrosis factors are there. These are the another factors, alpha, CD140B, CD146. These are the latest laboratory tests, but the laparoscopy is a gold standard. So, and the newer treatments, because we are getting many things. So, angiogenesis inhibitors, antioxidants, tumor necrosis factors, matrix metalloprotein inhibitors, these are there. There are Chinese method also. The green tea stem cell therapy is another future thing for the newer treatments part. And non-hormonal therapies are also there, immunomodulators and antiogenetic agents. So, these are the methods. And treatment, again, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory, anti-progesterone is there. Hormonal treatment, progesterone, disogestrol, GnRH, combined OC, denazole. And the latest molecule, which is we are finding it out, is a dinogest. And it's a really smart and very, very good molecule. It's coming up. And another is a selective progesterone receptor modulators and selective estrogen receptor modulators. In the Sunday evening, I'm teaching you endometriosis. I'm feeling so sad that the taking off all your time and on the Sunday. So just I'll finish it up. But the new drug which is coming up in the USA, this is a elagolix. This is a new phase 2-3 clinical trial introduced in the treatment of endometriosis. This is oral anti-gonadotrophic agent. They arrest the progression of the disease, though it's not available in India, elagolix, and dramatically reduce pain and significant effect at month 3 and 6 treatment. And the Proelix is another added thing because selective progesterone receptors. And these are the uliprostol, though it has got no role, but it's okay to be given. Is another new drug, resveratrol. This is also because it causes a suppressed effect and enhances the apoptosis of the endometrial stromal cell. So the lifestyle is so important. It's a concluding style. No intervention on lifestyle exercise. On the other hand, most patients believe in them and find them useful. Cognitive therapies and yoga is also there. Weight reduction, always we talk about whenever we are not able to treat any patient or anything like that in our life, we just start saying and blaming the weight. So weight is another very, very important point in dietary interventions, but not clearly demonstrated effect on. Gluten-free diets also improve the symptoms. So this is also there. Then the targeting stem cell for the treatment of endometriosis, relatively undifferentiated skill, replicate themselves, allowing continued cycles for the cellular regeneration, endometrial rapidly regenerated in each menstrual cycle. And it should not be surprising that the progenitor stem cells have been identified into the uterus. So the future directions are the identification of the putative endometrial stem cell in a numerous avenue for investigation. Then understanding cell fate determination with uterus includes epithelial stromal myometrium generated by the endometrial stem cell. Another future direction is the no, not all endometrial cells are sensitive to estrogen deprivation. So it's very, very important breakthrough into the research of endometriosis, the development of novel agent to specifically target stem cell. Endometriotic lesions is critically dependent on angiogenesis. And ultimately, the most effective therapeutic regime will likely require a combination of therapies, or you can say a tailor-made therapy. And the ideal medication for the endometriosis should be suppressive, treat pain, acceptable side effect profile, and long-term use should be safe and affordable, non-contraceptive nature, and non-interference. It's not possible. It's really academic. You will have get this type of medication. And it enhances the spontaneous conception, no teratogenic effect, aborts the development of new lesion, and efficacious for all endometrial phenotype including. It can include the superficial disease and it should work on everything. So the treatment of endometriosis needs to be individualized. Combination of surgical and medical treatment is the best option for the situation. Thank you so much. And the last thing which I always like to tell, present isn't a ritual that depends on closing our eyes and putting on the holy faces. We need a tender loving care for these patients, and we don't have to kneel or sit. We can pray while walking, driving and working. Thank you so much for the patient listening. After Rishikesh Paisar, so it's heavy for the endometriosis. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for that very informative and enlightening talk. And what I really loved about your presentation was your lovely slides and very colorful slides, which show some ray of hope for the patient of endometriosis. Really, the slides were very, very good. And definitely, all said and done, endometriosis is a very, very painful with all those. This really, it's a painful condition, and hope we come up with some kind of a therapy. Going into now gene therapy, everything is coming up, as you said about elagolix, which is a GnRH antagonist actually. So it is coming into picture. Hope it will be available in India also. And some there'll be some ray of hope for this patient. Thank you so much. It was a real, real wonderful talk. And I thank you for joining us for this session.
Thank you so much. Bhopal Society. And thank you. Special thanks to Hamare Sunil Goyalji.
Sunil Goyalji,
for inviting me today.
Thank you, Kavita Di. It was crisp and wonderful. As Mangla has rightly pointed out, the slides were really very attractive and very colorful.
Thank you so much,
and wish you a very good year ahead. And count on Bhopal Society. We are always there with you for any kind of work, whichever you will give us.
Yeah, hopefully we'll have AICOG in person. We'll be able to
bar, see bar, 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 hopefully, bol, bol ke dil na bar, dil na dukao.
No, hopefully we will have
it. Rishikesh Pai is there. He will find it out the way, and he will guide us and guard us. Guard us. Not only guide, he will guide and guard us. And I think we will graduate into the ceremony of AICOG.
Yes.
जाएगा तो वेव के बाद तीन चार महीना मिलता है ना.
सर आ जाएगा उसके पहले.
मंगला, इफ डॉक्टर पाई इज सेइंग समथिंग, just try to understand what he's saying.
Yes,
he will guide and guard both the things for us for AICOG. So all AICOG depends on Rishikesh Pai. That's the final answer.
Yes.
Anyway, we are definitely going to come to Indore. That's whatever
that,
happens.
That you are always welcome. Thank you so much, Anjali.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Bye, madam.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Bye.
Thank you so much, Dr.
Mudita.
Thank you.
Bye. Thanks to Rajiv Agarwal. Kidhar hai Rajiv Agarwal?
Yes, yes. Rajiv, sir was here.
Sunil,
I think so.
Sunil and Rajiv and Komal have been there from MQR. So, you know, MQR is a very important company for Foxy. Anyway, they always supported us.
Yes, right.
That's very true, sir.
And even Dr. Amit,
even I would like to thank them, because in a very short span, actually, we were looking for next 15 days for the website launch.
when this proposal came up, we thought, no, we want to have both of you on the ground to have this launch, and
you
have made it possible for us. Thank you, everyone, for making it possible today.
Okay.
Thank you, so much. Thank you, Dr. Amit Borse.
Shashi, we have Dr. Ken, Dr. Mudita. Can I play a small video of one of our division? Dr. Rajiv sir has joined pharma division, so he just would like to play a small video of his division. So I'll just share my screen with you.
Before that, I want to thank everyone for a great academic team. Thank you so much, respected sir, for great academic teams. Thank you, Kavita ma'am, for a wonderful directions on management of endometriosis. I think we all get benefited from this session. Thank you so much, Anjali ma'am, with your efforts, the website launch possible, and we all get updated with the website. Thank you so much, Meeta ma'am, Shashi ma'am, and Mangla ma'am, for giving us time, your valuable time to chair the session. And thank you, Dr. Varuna and Mudita, for website launch. Thank you, Rajiv ji, and MCO team, IV and Pharma. We all enjoyed the session and benefited by the extreme knowledge. Thank you, everyone, for attending the session.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, doctor. So I'll just start the video.
Dydrofem, faith delivered. Dydrofem is bioequivalent to innovator at 25% lower cost. It is made using complex photon bombardment and purification process. Dydrofem's structure is exactly like the reference dydrogesterone structure. This brand is brought to you by Dr. Mukund Gurjar, rated as one of the top 75 scientists in India by CSIR. Dydrofem is brought to you by Encure, India's number one company in women's health, most trusted by gynecologists. It is for patients with recurrent pregnancy loss, history of miscarriage, and defective luteal phase. It has better potency, bioavailability, and tolerability than progesterone. Dydrofem, Encure's dydrogesterone, proud to be made in India.
That's it, doctor. Thank you so much for your patient listening. Thank you. Bye. Doctor, should I end the meeting now, Dr. Anjali?
Yes, Komal, thank you so much for your support.
My pleasure.
You have always taken care of us. It's been a great association with MCure. You have been doing this last couple of webinars for us, and we look forward to have you more on the board.
Thank
you, Varuna. You were very special today. And how can I forget Mangla, my dear friend? She's sitting there very quietly, not saying anything.
All the members who have attended, given
us a big support for the website, and we look forward to have more and more inputs to have more things on the website. Thank you, everybody. Without the positive support of Mudita, Shabana, Varuna, and the blessings of Gore Didi, Madhuri Didi, Shraddha Didi, Meeta Didi, and many more, this day wouldn't have come. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Ji ma'am. Thank you, Mudita madam. It was a wonderful opportunity to serve this medical fraternity for the Bhopal Ops and Gynec Society. And definitely, future ahead, we'll do the many more webinars. And if you need any academic needs, so please suggest us. So definitely, will be the benchmark for us.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Komal, you can end the meeting.
I'll end the meeting. Sure.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Good night, doctor.
Heartiest congratulations.